Good morning. This is the first lecture in the series of lectures on the subject marketing management with the subject code BM370. This is an elective that is being offered to the BTech students to give them a glimpse of what marketing is all about. Well, to begin with, marketing today is considered to be one of the most vital components for the success of any business. It would not be an exaggeration to say that if businesses follow a great marketing campaign, then they can get access to increased sales and heightened brand awareness. No businesses, however small or however large they are, can ignore the concept of marketing in today's prevalent time. With the ongoing competition, with the rapid rate at which the consumer taste and preferences are changing, marketing has become all the more important. So let's begin this lecture series. Here I try to compile two sayings by some of the very great management thinkers. Peter Drucker, he said that because its purpose is to create a customer, your business has two purposes and two purposes only: marketing and innovation. In this thought gives us a clear-cut idea how important marketing coupled effect with innovation is important for the success of any business. It is also rightly said that if you think that if you have a good product into the market and consumer is going to come to you by himself, it is a sheer overlooking of the fact that customers may ignore you, may not come to you just because you are there into the market. Thus, it is your prerogative to move ahead, to go and target them, to go and catch them. There is another important saying which is given by David Packard. He says, marketing is too important to be left to the marketing department alone. Perhaps this is the reason that the introduction of a paper on marketing has been done for the engineering students as well. In this entire session, we are going to move through our steps of learning outcomes. This would look like this. We'll have a general introduction about this subject, why the study of marketing is important, background, evaluation of marketing role. We'll try to see some of the important definitions of marketing. We'll see functions and scope of marketing, some core concepts that will help us understand the importance of the definition of marketing. Companies have got different orientations towards this concept. We are going to learn them. We are going to see how marketing has shifted from the traditional role to the modern role. And most important, one misconception which is there in the market amongst the marketers, that selling and marketing are synonyms, which we'll try to see, is it so or is it not? And finally, we'll see some of the challenges that the marketing faces in today's present time. Coming on to the very first reason of studying this paper. Of course, as I just told you, that marketing is a vital component of any business. Today, presently, there is no business which has remained which is unaware of marketing. In fact, I would say that marketing is all pervasive in the true sense that it touches almost all the aspects of our life every day at every nook and corner. And thus, if it is so, why not develop a good understanding of it? Thus, we can say it plays an important role not only for the society, it plays an important role for the businesses, for its survival, for its profit, for its growth. Naturally, since marketing is considered to be a department in the organization, it offers career opportunities for people. At the same time, it affects our life on various levels as customers, as public, as stakeholders, as supplier, or any other different role that we may be following. Considering this, Let's go to understand how this all emerged, whether the way we look at marketing today, was it always like that, or it has emerged from a different role it was in the yesteryears. We as individuals have lots of requirements. We have several needs. We have needs of food, we have needs of clothing, we have needs of shelter, and in today's time we have need of having a good transportation, we have need of having good communication tools and many more electronic gadgets and so on and so forth. But then in the earlier times, the life of a human being was quite calm and easy. He just had two prime needs, and it was for food and clothing. For which, I would say food and shelter, not even clothing. And it was at this point of time that the human were self-sufficient. They either satisfied their need by, collecting the things around, or by hunting things around. And therefore, they were largely not dependent on each other. But with the passage of time, when the needs started growing, when the individuals started to realize that there is something more which is required to improve the quality of life, they started looking out for things from others. It was at this point of time that people started identifying other people who were having something. For example, I have wheat, but I would like to consume fish or say chicken. Then this person was looking out for somebody who was having fish or chicken. This simple system is, as we know, is known as the exchange system or the barter system. However, this barter system had one major flaw, and which made it slightly inefficient. And this flaw was for two people of two requirements to find each other. You know, I may be having wheat, as I just now said, and I may want a fish, but then a person wanting fish and a person wanting meat with each other, it was difficult to find them. At the second time, there was no equivalency in two products. How was one sack of wheat equal to one fish? Or how many fishes were to be exchanged in return of one sack of wheat? That was a major problem. With that group conflicts, in order to get over this conflict, a simple system of exchange was introduced in the form of money, in the form of currency. It was here that for the first time, consumers realized that this system of exchange can be made easy by introducing money value. And then this system of exchange got converted into something which is known as transaction. You pay money and you get things in return. It was at this point of time that people also realized that if they want to buy more from the market, they need to have more money, for which they themselves have to produce more so that the excess can be sold into the market and money can be earned for it. The same money can then be utilized for buying what they would need and want. This gave birth to what is typically known as market, one of the most important concepts in marketing. It is here that buyers and sellers come and meet together, therefore we can call it a physical place or a geographical location, where it gives both the parties an access to interact with each other and exchange the goods and services that they have. Later on, as the excess items were being sold into the market were made very competitive. Simply because, in the earlier times, probably there were just one or two people who were selling cloth or one or two people selling shoes. But then as people started producing more, the number of sellers increased. The number of sellers grew such that consumers started to have much more choice. And in order to grab the attention of the customers, the businesses had to develop a different orientation. They developed a different orientation of looking at the customer. This made the customer very, very important. At the same time, this made the problem of selling difficult. Now the producers were in a fix because they found that their time was to be divided amongst two major activities. One was production and the second one was selling. This generated the need to find somebody who was a specialist seller, and which gave birth to somebody which is known as the middleman. The intermediaries whose task is to take the finished good from the producers and get it made available to the customers. Again, it is important to realize that initially where the focus was on production, the focus has now shifted on to sales. At the same time, two important things I've mentioned here. It is not just about identifying and getting hold of a customer, but it is also about retaining the customers. Therefore, three major shift areas were observed. Sales became important, customers became important, and at the same time, joining new customers became important. Again, selling could not be done well without really understanding the needs and wants of the customers. Therefore, customer became all the more important. A customer-oriented approach had to be used, which paved the path for the businesses getting converted into marketing organizations. It was perhaps here that for the first time, the first major transition in the businesses was observed. Again, it is important to know that in today's time, we are having a very dynamic business environment. It is not just full of organizations which are working to earn profit, but then there is an existence of a group of companies who are working for non-profit reasons as well. Such organizations are known as the non-profit organization or the non-commercial organization. I have mentioned the examples of temples and the churches here. Even they are, we cannot say that they are untouched by marketing. Even they are doing marketing. So, for example, the church provides a product in the form of the prayer services that they give, in the form of the, the collection of people where they come and celebrate some festivals and do its congregation, who here is the customer. Now, in order to make the people aware that company, the church has to announce this activity by way of promotion to this congregation who is the target customer. And it largely depends on these congregation or these people who come for the prayer, for the price or the payment they make in the form of the membership fee or say in the form of the charity donations that they give for its survival. Further, it is located where the congregation can have easy access, a place. So four important things are seen in here which help us realize that in addition to the commercial organization, the non-commercial organizations are also engaged in the activity of marketing. Finally, we have to understand one of the most important things, which says that customer is, was and will be one of the most important element of any marketing organization. And therefore, the businesses have to strive very hard to satisfy this customer. In a nutshell, simply put, we can say that no customer means no business. If this customer is so important, we need to understand where he actually resides. You know, this figure gives us a simple data of a simple market system. I've just now told you that market is a place where sellers and buyers meet. If you see here, I've written sellers giving products and services to the buyer and buyer in return giving money to the seller. Also, we have to realize that there is not just one seller present in the market, it is a collection of sellers, and a collection of sellers is known as industry. At the same time, there can be various buyers into the market. Some may be willing to buy, some may not be willing to buy at this point of time, whom we call as the potential or the prospective customer. The collection of these buyers is what is known as the market. So we have an industry, collection of sellers. We have a market, which is a collection of buyers. Seller provides product and market in turn provides money. Again, it is important to realize that if this transaction is not taking place, it does not mean that the businesses are sleeping. You know, a business is required to constantly engage in dialogue with its customer. Therefore, they generate various communication and promotion exercises to make the consumer aware about the changes that have incurred, to make them aware about the new products that they are bringing into the market. And in turn, they are largely interested in getting this information in the form of feedback from the customer so that they can improvise, modify and upgrade their operations. Moving ahead, it is also important to understand that it is not just between the seller and the buyer that the entire equation takes place. In addition to these sellers and buyer, a number of participants or let's say actors are present in this modern marketing system. This figure helps us understand this. If you see clearly, this is the seller I was talking about, the company who is providing the goods to this end customer. So if you see, this is the seller here, this is the buyer here. And I just want to tell you that again, it is not just one seller who is selling a product into the market, it is a group of sellers. Therefore, while the seller is here, his competitors are here. For example, understand, if you want to buy a brand of refrigerator from the market, you have got Godrej, you have got Calvinator, you have got Samsung, you have got LG, a number. If you are willing or keen on buying an LG refrigerator, that company would come here, but the other 3-4 would come here. They are the competitors. Together, this would form something which is known as the industry, a collection of sellers. And then here you have the buyer, who is you, the end user. But then the things are not easy. I told you in the first slide that when the producers found that it was hard to divide their times among selling and manufacturing, they appointed specialist sellers who are known as the middlemen or the intermediaries. You see, it's here. Therefore, this industry is trying to get to the end consumer through these middlemen who are known as the intermediaries. But in order to manufacture things here, for example, a refrigerator manufacturing requires iron, it requires compressors, it requires plastic, and it requires paint and many other things. They are dependent on several suppliers. This supplier could be provided to this company as well as to its competitors as well. So simply put, we can see suppliers, we can see distributors or intermediaries here, we can see our seller here, his competitors here, and the end user. Together, they form a comprehensive market system. As against the simple market system we just saw in the last slide, this is the presence of all the other participants in a comprehensive marketing system. Coming ahead, see, of course, businesses realized the importance of marketing, but it was not an overnight phenomenon. It was a gradual shift. Businesses took time to understand how marketing was becoming all the more effective. And it is clearly depicted in this diagram. We have tried to show the shift of marketing from its traditional viewpoint to what it looks like today through a 5 pentagram. The first figure, if you see, it shows that out of the 4 functions which are commonly seen in any business, biz, production, finance, HR and marketing, all have equal importance. None of them was considered to be superior than the other. It was at this point of time that the people were doing their own work and they were leaving things on the fate. It was later that it was realized that no, there is a department who should be given more responsibility to get across to this customer on whom our fate depends. If he doesn't buy, profit is not coming in. Therefore, marketing was given a major role here. If you see, the proportion of importance given to marketing in correspondence to the other three has increased. Therefore, we say that marketing is an important function. Perhaps this also did not help the businesses much. And therefore, businesses realized that, see, we need to separate selling from marketing from production, and let's give that one department who shall be responsible for whole and sole dealing with the customer to acquire the center stage. Marketing was identified as the major function. It was given the center stage, whereas all the others, the HR, the finance, the production, IT, all were acquiring the circumferencing role. They were acting as the supplementary departments helping marketing. I have also told you in the first few slides that marketing is a very important activity which cannot be left to the marketing department alone. Therefore, there was all the departments were expected to play a supplementary role, and that is depicted in the third figure. But then the major changes came here. The major changes came here in the fourth and the fifth shift, where we were shifting from the traditional market to today's contemporary modern marketing concept. If you see the fourth figure, it was for the first time, it was realized that yes, if customer is the most important one whom we are trying to get across in the first three stages, why not give him his due importance? And therefore, it was customer who acquired the center stage. Entire organizational exercises became customer centric. All was done keeping the customer in focus. What should be done for him? How it should be done for him? And let's do it for him. Again, marketing took a stage role, and it was expected that all the other departments are going to perform the role of a supplementary department, whereas customer is going to be the controlling function. However, again, the same problem was felt, which was perhaps felt here. Who is the whole and sole responsible department for this customer satisfaction? And thus, the responsibility once again was given to marketing. And whereas customer came at the center, marketing was at one department which was touching customer on the boundaries, giving the cushion to the customer from any hardships that he or she may face while he's thinking and deciding to buy a certain product. And therefore, I would not say that the other departments are not communicating with the customer, but the first hand role, the first hand responsibility was given to marketing to correspond with this customer. Again, one important shift that I am going to tell you is, whereas here the organization efforts were customer centric, here the organization became customer oriented. Marketing became an integrative function. The role of marketing was not just to keep in touch with this customer, but was to act as a semi permeable porous department which interacts with all the other departments, so that the prime focus of the company, the customer, can be given more and more satisfaction. It was perhaps here that the terminology like customer delight was introduced, which means that it is not just enough to just make sure that your customer is satisfied. You know, satisfaction is a level where a consumer expects certain amount of happiness with the user of a product for which he or she has given money. But then in today's time, it's not just enough. So if there's a customer who's buying a plate of noodles or pasta from the market, and if it just tastes good, that's not just enough. There is something additional extra required, and therefore with that burger, you are required to give a paper napkin, you are required to give a sachet of tomato ketchup, so that a customer feels, you know, good about it, a customer feels pleasured about it, and that is what the level of customer delight is. Clearly, let's just review it again. The shift of importance of marketing has seen various phases. From acquiring just simple and equal role, it has come to become an integrative function. It is one of the most vital functions for the success of any organization, because it is that department which is in the closest contact with the customer, who is perhaps the most important reason for a business existence. figure also helps us to see how marketing has shifted from the traditional role to acquire the marketing's modern role. This is also helping us to understand that here, where there was no existence of the buyer, this type of market was known as the seller's market. And here, the buyer has come to acquire the center stage, and therefore it has made buyer the this has made the market a buyer's market. So we can say that the shift of the marketing from the traditional role to the buyer's to the modern role is perhaps what we know as shifting from the seller's market to today's buyer market, where the buyer decides the definition of the market, the buyer decides what sells, how much it sells, and what is not going to sell. And thus, this buyer and his satisfaction is most important. In the next line, let's also understand that marketing in itself has got several shades and dimensions. There is a lot of literature available on how this marketing should be defined. For the sake of simplicity and for the sake of avoiding confusion, I just tried to summarize three very simple definitions of marketing and marketing management. This slide will help us understand the simplest marketing definition. Till now, we have come to the conclusion that the department of marketing and the marketing managers have the primary responsibility of delivering customer satisfaction at a profit. Thus, we can say that the smallest definition of marketing is meeting needs profitably, which means that if a business thinks of earning profit at the cost of the customer, they may be there into the market, but not for a longer run. And thus, companies should aim at a win-win situation where the companies make profit but via customer satisfaction. If I can give you one comprehensive definition of marketing, before that I would like to tell you, on the basis of the above definition, there are just two goals that a business tries to achieve through marketing. The first one is to attract new customers by promising superior value. Of course, it is important for a company to gain attention of new customers and keep adding new numbers to their fleet. But the second one is also to keep the current customers by delivering satisfaction. It does not mean that if a new customer is coming, the older ones can go. Because retention is as important. If you are letting your old customers leave, naturally your figures are not increasing. And therefore, adding the new customers and retaining the older ones, both are equally important for the business success. From that point of view, since we have been talking about the word selling again and again, one of the greatest misconceptions that people have is they think that marketing is selling. The answer is a clear-cut no. Marketing is not selling. Some of the reasons have been mentioned here. The first and foremost reason is selling is just a part of marketing. In that sense, we can say that marketing is a broad phenomenon, whereas selling is just a short-term activity. It starts and ends with the with just the selling of the product to the end consumer. One of the most important things, which is mentioned in point 2, marketing starts long before the company has a product or service. Indeed, it begins from the day the company starts thinking of entering a market. It begins from the day the company starts identifying the target customers who they may possibly satisfy. And thus, marketing begins. It begins with the communication with the possible customers. It begins with identifying the market environment in which they would have to go and play. And thus, marketing has begun. Selling, whereas begins only once the product are ready in the manufacturing department and now they are ready to exchange hands with the customers. Marketing involves homework, such as assessing the needs of the customers, measuring the extent of their need, and determining whether profitable opportunities exist in the market. This is very important to understand that in today's time, everything has a certain cost. It's not just money, but it is the time and the effort also. And thus, if there is a certain market where in the first phase of study, it appears that a substantial profit is not going to result, it is better not to enter those markets. On the other hand, selling occurs only after the product is manufactured or it is created. In that sense, we can say marketing is a part and parcel of a product's entire life. Finding new customers, improving the product appeal and performance, and managing repeat sales. So Philip Kotler, who is the father of modern marketing management, has helped us understand that marketing and selling are two different dimensions. Of course, selling is included in marketing, or we can say that marketing precedes sales. Marketing develops the ground where selling can be done. Marketing reduces the work burden on the sellers. But then typically marketing is not selling. On that basis, let's see the first definition of marketing given by Philip Kotler in his Millennium Edition in the year 2000. This is perhaps the most comprehensive definitions of marketing, which states that marketing is a managerial and societal process by which individuals and groups obtain what they need and want through creating, offering and freely exchanging products and services of value with each other. This definition is also very important because it gives us different aspects which help us understand what marketing is all about. The first step is mentioned in point one. Marketing is a managerial and societal process. The second one is given here, where individuals and group obtain what they need and want. This is the third one. Through either creating, offering and exchanging. The fourth one is products and services, and the last one is value. Therefore, we need to understand the different dimensions to understand this definition, which we'll do just a little later. But before we go there, I would also want you to understand that this is the definition of an activity which is marketing, which is restricted, actually not restricted, but which is the prerogative of the marketing department. This is the definition of marketing as an activity. Identifying and finding out what the consumers want, giving it to them in the right format at the right time, so that profits are earned through customer satisfaction. A simple definition. But the subject that we are learning is marketing management. It has got two different words, marketing and management, coming, which is this, which actually is explained by this definition. It says that the most prestigious institutions on marketing, the AMA, American Marketing Association, defines marketing management as the process of planning and executing the conception, pricing, promotion and distribution of ideas, goods and services to create exchange that satisfy individual and organizational goal. Again, please understand that since it is the definition of marketing management, the aspects of management in the form of planning and execution are to be seen here. So any marketing activity which is properly planned and executed is perhaps marketing management. But then we also have to understand, while planning and executing this process, what we are doing? We are conceiving a product, we are pricing it appropriately, we are promoting it in the right manner, and we are distributing this. These three words, they help us understand the scope of marketing activity, which also I will tell you in detail in just a few minutes. It is entirely a company's idea what they want to make available to the customers. It is just a product, or is it a service, or it is an idea. But then for that also, they have to keep in mind that the individual should be satisfied, and at the same time it is the organization who should be satisfied. Simply, we can say it is talking about customer satisfaction and profit. So marketing management can be easily classified as, or easily stated as, a process of planning and executing the conception, pricing, promotion and distribution of goods and services in order to create exchange that will lead to customer satisfaction and the organization earning profit. Let's come here. As I was just now telling you, the scope of marketing, this slide helps us understand what is the scope of marketing. What are the various range of offerings which a company can provide to the customer. Clearly, we can see that everything in the market is being marketed today. Whether it is places like our own country, India, where we are trying to attract people in order to increase the tourism development. So we have got incredible India, we have got Goa, Malaysia, truly Asia. Such campaigns are being done so that people go to that country and the tourism will get accelerated. Properties in the form of real estate, farmhouses, offices are being sold. Organizations, so there are organizations like hospital, Apollo, Fortis, who are also marketing themselves. There is educational institutions like, prestigious IITs and IIMs and Singhal University, who are also marketing itself. Then there are goods in the form of pen, car or refrigerator or any other thing we use. Services, these two are perhaps the most traditional things which are available in the market. Services being a relatively recent addition, but these ones are more contemporary. So services, you have services of doctors, teachers, chartered accountants, experiences. So you go to a theme park or you go to an amusement park and you enjoy the rides there the whole day, you enjoy the food, but then you do not get to bring anything in return. You get nothing, no rides, nothing in return. You just carry an experience with you. So even that is being marketed. Information, so we have got Google and Wiki, where lots of information is available. Ideas, if you go a decorator or a vascom, you know, decorator, and ask him to help you, you know, redefine how your houses can be redecorated. It's there. Events, there are prestigious award functions, New Year parties where you go, and again, it's like an experience that it was on a particular day you went, and then that event will either recur after a certain point of time or it may not recur at all. And the last one is person. So we see that it's various actors, sportsmen and politicians who are also marketing themselves. Narendra Modi being one of the most important example, who's marketing himself, with lots of energy these days. What I want you to understand from this slide is that marketing today is not just restricted to marketing products and services. The scope has extended to encompass almost everything which can be marketed into the market. In fact, it has become, the market has become so revolutionized that we are presently in that age where even the brides and grooms are being marketed through matrimonial sites. This will help us understand the extent of what all can be marketed. Perhaps there is nothing which remains untouched. Almost everything can be marketed. If everything can be marketed, what is the function or the task a marketing manager has to perform? This slide helps us understand that it is this marketing department who is the voice of the customer within the firm. It is the responsibility of this marketing department to pick up things from the market and communicate them back to the company. It is this marketing department who collects feedback and passes it on to the relevant department so that appropriate changes can be made in the marketing efforts. It is this marketing department who acts as the sensory organ of the company, who senses and sensitizes the company about what all the consumer may want. In this slide, I'll try to just summarize four of the important tasks that a marketing manager or a marketer needs to perform. The first one is analyzing the industries which are emerging. This will help the business to understand what are the opportunities there in the market where they can enter. The second one is to take a very important decision related to whether they want to go into the national markets, the domestic markets, or the international markets. Therefore, identifying the target markets to enter. The third one is to conduct research at appropriate time intervals in order to understand the consumer behavior. Again, it is very relevant to understand that since everything depends on this customer, his behavior needs to be mapped at regular intervals, simply because he is not going to remain same throughout his life. And the last one, which is very important, designing the integrated marketing mixes, which is a composition of four P's: product, price, place and promotion. This is going to be the subject of our second lecture, where we are going to study this marketing mix in detail. But right now, to put in a nutshell, assess the marketing opportunities, identify the target markets to enter, conduct research at regular intervals, and develop an integrated marketing mix so that your entry, your sustenance and your survival into the market becomes easier. The definition that I just showed you two slides back, there I was telling you that the definition is important because it helps us understand five different aspects of the definition. They are put in here. In order to understand a marketing definition better, we need to understand these five things: needs, wants and demands, products and services, value satisfaction, exchange, transactions and relationships, and market. Market, already we have talked about a single market system and the main factors in the earlier slides. Let's come on to see this. It typically looks like this. There's a group of customers who have got certain needs and demands. They may want a car, they may want food items, they may want a home, or they may want, you know, jewelry or anything. In order to satisfy these needs, they want certain products which are available through them. You know, for example, if you want comfort at home, you may be requiring an air conditioner, or you may be requiring a refrigerator. When you get these products from the market, you expect certain satisfaction, you expect certain quality because you are giving money for it. This goods are acquired by you through either an exchange process or a transaction process, and if everything goes on well, of course, something like a long-term relationship is also expected. And finally, all of this is happening in the market, and the buyers and sellers are available in the market. Let's try to see these five core concepts of marketing, beginning from the first one, which is needs and wants. Two most important words which help us understand how market actually takes shape. And it begins with this word need, which is the basic state of deprivation. Every human has got certain needs. It may be for simple needs like for for food and water. They may be complex, like need for self-esteem, need for achievement, anything. But then every human has got some types of needs which are unsatisfied at a point in time. It is from this point that the entire marketing process starts. But then, if it was just about needs, if it was just about a few sellers into the market, this need would have never changed into something more specific. But then how many of us today just want to have food, any kind of food? No, we've got specific requirements. Some of us wants to have a double cheeseburger, somebody wants to have a thin crust pizza, somebody wants to have a pani puri. Everybody has got certain requirement which is specific, particular, we know what it is, and which has helped us shift from needs and wants. We have come here, wants have taken specific form, whereas a human is not going to be satisfied until and unless whatever he or she demands is wants is available. And thus it is here that wants came in the form of specific addresses, specific solutions to your problems. It was here that the company had to realize that your wants are shaped by several factors which are inculcated in your culture or which are there in your genes, either by birth or you have learned them through your course of life. But then comes the third one, which is demand. It is interesting to note that demand is a very, very statistical term, because we may want to have a number of things, but until and unless we have the purchasing power to buy it, it is of no use. Therefore, demand is something which is backed by buying power. And the funny part is, if it were just for this, marketing wouldn't have existed. Marketing exists for these two. It is here that the marketers are trying to develop a particular product into the market, and it is here that the marketers are trying to establish and launch a brand into the market. In order to satisfy these needs and wants, what are available are products and services. Typically, as I've just told you, the first thing that was offered into the market was a product, a tangible, a material, a physical commodity which the people could see, touch, feel and store, and if they do not want, they could use it for a later occasion. But services, on the other hand, are totally intangible. They are ones which cannot be seen and touched, but they can only be felt and experienced. Second, they cannot be owned. They are one-timers. It is just like going to a doctor for getting yourself treated, and then the moment you meet a doctor and pay the fee, that transaction is over. The next time you have to go, you have to pay again, and you have to get that service. In order to utilize that service again, you have to pay again. The third very important word for marketing, yes, is this. The three triplets: value, satisfaction and quality. Value is a consumer's perceived expectation about how much a product should cost. You know, how much a person is getting and how much a person is giving. It's a trade-off between them. So if the payments that the person has made and the benefits that he or she is receiving, if there is a huge gap in that, it would result into something which is known as dissatisfaction. And in order to make sure that a consumer is satisfied, the payments should be more than what is received, and therefore there should be a positive outcome. Satisfaction, on the other hand, again, it is a very, very relative phenomena. It's a perceived phenomena. Two people at the same time with one similar thing may have satisfaction or dissatisfaction levels. Finally, quality. Again, it is a consumer's judgment of what is the utility or usefulness of a product. For him, it means the product should be free from any defects. On the other hand, for the company, it means that a good quality product can have a higher price. A good quality product means defectless. That is what it means. The fourth important word in this terminology is exchange, transaction and relationships. As we have just learned in the first slides, that the first mode of getting goods from the market was through the barter system or the exchange system. So people were offering goods with each other in return of some certain other goods. But with the introduction of the value of money came the process of transaction, where there was a trade inquiry between two parties. One party gave goods of value, and in return they got money. Again, the exchange was to be agreed upon by both the parties, and the value was to be decided by both the parties. The third very important term that we have mentioned in here is relationship marketing. And this is indeed here that the role of marketing becomes more magnified. Because companies, as we've been studying till now, the goal for marketing is to get new customers and to retain the old ones. It is here that the company endeavors to foster a long-term long-term relationship with its customer. The idea is to get them and keep them as long as they can. And therefore, it is required to develop relationships with not just the customers, but with all the type of stakeholders which are there in the company. Thus, in order to understand the definition of marketing, we need to understand the concept of market. We need to understand the concept of needs and wants. We need to understand what products and services are. We need to understand what exchange, transaction and relationship is all about. At the same time, there is something which is value to the customer. There is something which is satisfaction, which the company should look forward to. And finally, they should provide quality. These five core concepts help us understand the definition of marketing. In the next series, I'm going to tell you that no doubt companies realize that marketing was important. But within marketing, there are a number of disciplines. Marketing is vested with the responsibility of doing advertisement. Marketing is vested with the responsibility of aiding sales. Marketing is given the responsibility of identifying customers. Marketing is given the responsibility of conducting research. So many things are there. And thus, at different point of time, the companies have had different orientations or different ideologies towards marketing. In the initial times, the companies thought that marketing's task is only to make good products. Later, they thought that marketing's task is to make good sales. Later on, they thought that marketing's task is to keep the customer satisfied. The upcoming slide will help us understand how the company orientations and philosophies have shifted through various stages. There are five alternative concepts under which organizations conduct their marketing activities. There is a production concept, product concept, selling concept, marketing concept, and societal marketing concept. Let's have a look at those. The first concept, the production concept. It simply says that it's a philosophy where the company simply believes that if you make highly affordable products for the market, if you make them available at the right places, your product is going to sell and thus you are going to make profit and your company is going to be there in the market for a long time. In another words, it means that if a company improves its production facility, your purpose of business is done. So in the initial time, the production concept said that the marketing orientation, the marketing ideology was primarily concerning to improve the production, produce more. They were not concerned with coming up with different variety. It was just about mass production. Later on, they realized that no, there is a group of customer who would not be satisfied with the common products. And thus, in order to keep them satisfied, what is required is to come up with products which have got quality, make products which give good performance, and which have got certain innovative features. Therefore, the focus shifted to the product part, making the product more better, making the product innovative. But then, this also did not solve the problem. And thus, the companies were forced to shift their focus to this one. They thought that if a consumer is left free, he would not buy willingly. And thus, he needs to be pushed just that little bit so that he or she enters into a purchase process. This slide, this particular concept helps us understand that a consumer will buy only when a company undertakes a mass selling effort. When the company takes an energetic, enthusiastic selling effort, where the company becomes aggressive in order to make the customer realize that yes, you need to have this product. But then, as I've just told you, that companies were smart enough to realize that neither production nor product nor selling is going to help you until and unless you pay real attention to that one person who's your customer. And thus, marketing as an integrative function acquired a major role and came to marketing concept. This fourth concept enunciates that for the basic purpose of a business existence is to justify itself socially and economically. The social and economic justification for a business existence is the satisfaction of its customer. The customer should be satisfied in terms of meeting his needs and wants, at the same time earning the organization objectives, whether they are to become the market leader or it is to acquire a large amount of profit or whether it is to minimize the cost. This next slide helps us understand how this will be done, how you are going to satisfy your customer at the same time, make profit. You are going to do it through this three-pronged strategy. The first one is, you have to develop an orientation which is customer-oriented. You have to develop a philosophy where the consumer is the most important thing. Everything should happen for him, everything should come from him, everything should go through him. Second is an integrative effort. effort. It is not just the responsibility of the marketing department, but all the other departments should get together, integrate their efforts so that the customer is satisfied. And finally, goal achievement at two levels. Satisfying the customer and making appropriate amounts of profitable which are required for your survival and sustenance into the market are required. Thus, the marketing concept says that through an integrative approach, through a customer-oriented approach, the goal achievement of the organization can become easier. The last concept that the companies are following in the present time is the societal marketing concept. It says that the idea that the organization should determine the needs, wants and interests of target market and deliver the desired satisfaction should be done more effectively and efficiently than the competitors. At the same time, they should maintain the consumers and society's well-being. So in addition to everything that we have learned in the last slide, here one more party has come in, and that is the society, which means that if you are a company making a particular product which is very pricey so that a common man cannot afford it, does not mean that you do not have any responsibility towards them. You are required to indulge yourself into such activities which are not going to increase the standard of living of your customer only, but they would work for the sustainable development of the society, of the public at large. Here, we need to understand one very, very important difference, and that is of selling and marketing. Having said much about marketing, having incorporated selling into this discussion, we have developed certain understanding what selling and marketing is. And this slide, the selling concept vis-a-vis marketing concept, clearly helps us understand how these two can be differentiated. I have taken four bases. The first one is the selling point. The second one is the focus. The third one is the means, and the fourth one is end. So if you see a selling concept, the starting point is the factory jahan saman ban raha hai. Whereas the marketing concept, the starting point is the market where the consumer actually is. Because we will start with what the consumer wants rather than just going into the market and offering him what we have made. Here the focus is on the products that the company has made, jo unhone bana liya hai. Whereas here the focus is on the customer need because we have asked him what you want. Here, the means is to sell what you have made. Promote it, sell it aggressively so that it goes into the market. Whereas here, the focus, the means to get to your customer's need is through integrated approach. Developing a good product, pricing it appropriately, promoting it rightly, and placing it so that it is conveniently and comfortably affordable to the, available to the customer. And finally, the end point, the objective of any selling effort would be profit and profit alone through sales volume. Whereas the objective of any marketing concept would be profit through customer satisfaction. It helps us understand clearly that the selling concept depends on the make and sell approach, banao or becho. Whereas this approach clearly rests on ask, make, tell and sell approach. So pucho, banao, batao or becho. This helps us understand that we have shifted from the production concept to the product concept to the selling concept, the marketing concept and society concept, and perhaps that is one way of looking how the role of marketing has changed from the traditional times to the modern times. Finally, I would like you to understand that in order to be there into the market in the present time, there are three principal angles that the companies should really be concerned with. Three fundamental pillars on which they can expect to rest their canopy of profit on. The first one is the society, the human welfare, the people around you. The second one is the consumers, naturally, the people whom you are trying to serve. And the third one is you yourself as a company, because you have a certain priority to earn profits as well. So nothing should be done at the cost of these two. But then at the same time, the profits should also not be ignored. So a three-pronged strategy would thus be encompassed in something which is called the social marketing role. How this can be done? I've just listed three basic things. You can try to make products which are less toxic and less harmful to the environment. You can try to make products which are more durable, so like televisions and smaller products like bulbs or lights or phones, which can work for a longer duration, or which do not get exhausted in smaller durations of time. And the third one is to use products which are made up of reusable and recyclable material. Thus, production concept, product concept, selling concept, marketing concept and the societal marketing concept are the five orientations that a company can follow. Again, one very important concept. See, See, of course, in all the five orientations, we have seen that the company has shifted their focus either from the production part to the selling part. But then typically, one should understand that one should never forget the basic purpose of business, and that is customer satisfaction. This marketing myopia concept was given by Theodore Levin, and he said that companies often end up developing a narrow mindset, a short-sightedness, where they become over-obsessed with the products and services that they are selling into the market. Either they try to improvise them so much that they forget that in this endeavor, the product are becoming more pricey and the customer may not be able to avail them. Thus, a customer may either stop using it, or the customer may not find it that suitable to meet out their needs. Or sometimes a company forgets what the customer wants and they try to develop a product in the way they want it to be. This marketing myopia is a type of a short-sightedness. It is a distorted vision where the organizations virtually ignore or neglect the customer and his needs and wants. And this should be avoided. Otherwise, the company is going to be there only in a short run and should not think about long-term survival. A review of the five philosophies. Production is concerned with what we can make or do in the best manner. Sales just talks about selling aggressively. Marketing talks of what customer wants and needs. And there is societal. Yes, it thinks about what the customer wants and needs, but at the same time, it thinks about the society's welfare and the benefit of the society as well. To conclude this session, let's just talk about the different types of challenges that the companies are facing today. One of the most important challenges that the business market is seeing today is the development of this non-profit market. A group of people who have come in there who are typically shouting and voicing out that they are not there to make the profit. And thus, the type of activities that they indulge in are different from what the profit-making companies do. Second, of course, the boom of the information technology segment. We are perhaps in the most dynamic of the eras where everything is just a click away. We are virtually no longer dependent on the traditional brick and mortar outlets where we have to go and buy the products in a traditional way. We can sit in the confines of our home, in the comforts of our home, and buy things at the mere click of the button on your laptops. The third one is rapid globalization, which has made the world a global village. Boundaries have virtually disappeared. People have come in, and this has increased the competition to possibly the most highest level ever. The fourth one is changing world economy. The consumer tastes and preferences, the availability of money in the market, the inflation rates, all have changed manyfold what they were about 10-20 years back. And the last one, the latest buzz in the market is the ethics part. Doing things ethically, doing things morally, and perhaps it is there that marketing is facing several problems. We will discuss this in the coming lectures, but one thing I would want you to understand is that the moment you start thinking about your society's welfare, ethics, moral values come in automatically. And one should realize that to be in the market, let us adopt the right way. That is what is meant in here. I would like to conclude my session by telling you that the past decade taught business firms everywhere a very humbling lesson. There are three important learnings that the business have learned. The first one is that a domestic company has learned that there is no way they can stay in the market by ignoring the global markets and the competitor. They are there to come, and thus it is high time to rise up and realize and do something about it. The second is a successful company who, with mature businesses have learned that they cannot ignore the emerging markets or the technology and management approaches. So if you are ready to wind up your business and go out of the market, then it is okay. But if you want to stay in there, you need to adopt the changes as they are happening around you. And finally, companies of every sort, whether they are small or mid caps or the large scale companies, they have to understand that they cannot stay into the market if they choose to invert the focus. Agar aap apne bare mein hi apne andar hi dekhkar chalenge aur apne bahar ki duniya ko ignore karenge, then you cannot stay there for a long time. And one of the most important thing is you cannot stay there by ignoring the needs of the customers and the environment in which you are operating. You have to be vigilant, you have to be open-eyed, you have to be sensitive towards it, sense it and make changes accordingly so that you can stay in the market for as long as possible. This is just the introductory primary part of marketing that will help us understand what primary changes have taken place. As we move forward, we are going to learn about the marketing process and what are the various types of steps that have to be incurred in there. Typically, we are going to speak about the 4 P's of marketing mix in the next lecture. But as for this lecture, I have compiled certain references which will help you to gain more detailed knowledge in the topics that we have discussed. One of the most important books that you can refer for marketing is the book by Kotler. If you see, he's almost everywhere. But there are several books which are on the international aspect, and there are several books on the Asian aspects as well. So this is going to help you. Thank you.